First, I would like to thank the organizers. Maybe you notice that all three organizers have a name which starts with S, so it's a triple S. So some of you might have heard about the intermolecular or interatomic Coulombic decay, which is, I will explain it a little later, is a mode of relaxation of excited systems in environment. And I would like to we started exploring it by free electron lasers. Of course, we are theoreticians, so when I say exploring, it's still on paper. And an idea behind it, which actually was pointed out by the referee, is that one can learn from it also that how energy, because in a free electron laser, you deposit a lot of energy into one site, an atom or a small molecule, how the energy can be dissipated to the environment. And so this is an issue here. Let me see. I have to switch it on. Yeah, so let me start with explaining what we know about an isolated system before I go to a system in an environment. And of course, I will concentrate on an excited ion, but in principle, it doesn't matter whether you have an ion, a neutral system, whatever. But I would like to be specific. And if you have an excited ion and you remove a, let's say the ion is created by removing a core electron, we all know there is Auger decay. I'm not talking about very heavy elements where you have X-ray emission and who knows what kind of cascades. I want to keep it short. So you have an Auger decay, so one electron falls into the vacancy, closes the vacancy, fills the vacancy, and another one flies out. And this is has a wide range of applications, analytical applications, and it's a very fast process, one of the fastest processes we know, femtosecond, even into the sub-femtosecond regime. And if we remove an valence electron, here I separate them into outer valence and inner valence, then you usually have radiative decay in an atom or a small system. So an electron falls in here and a photon is emitted. So, and this we all know, but it's a relatively slow process. So it best, so to say, nanoseconds. And what happened if this isolated system has now a partner, let's say a neighbor, or is in an environment? I will speak about more neighbors later. Then you have what we call ICD, so the intermolecular or interatomic, if these are atoms, Coulombic decay. So it's a long-range correlation effect. And what happens if I remove here an inner valence? So in the system now, this could only, if it was isolated, as we show, it can only decay by emitting a photon. But having a neighbor, now the energy can be transferred to the neighbor, and you can kick out an electron from the neighbor. So you have two ions at the end. You started with one ion, and you have a neighboring ion, and then you have a Coulomb explosion. These two will just fly apart, and this gives additional damage to the system. Now we'll come back later a little. I'll give some examples before I go to the free electron laser. So it's quite a general phenomenon. It's found in many systems, and not only for ions, of course, and in hydrogen-bonded systems. Van der Waals clusters, recently in helium-2. It's a wonderful measurement by the Dörner group in Frankfurt. And now we started studying what happens in quantum dots. You also see that there is ICD. It's usually ultra fast, it's femtosecond regime, and very important, it becomes faster the more neighbors you have. So if you have many neighbors, it can be very, very fast. I'll show an example later. And what is relevant for us in the last years, it became more and more clear to us that the low energy electrons produced by ICD, this ICD electron, which is kicked out here by after transfer of energy from the initially excited system to the neighbor, they are very slow. So they have energies between 0 and 10 eV or something like that. We'll see an example. And importantly, it has been noticed about a decade ago, it has been noticed that the damage done to biological systems is not by the photons, but by the slow electrons produced. And this produces slow electrons automatically at the site where you create the ion. Yes?
Why isn't an Auger process possible in this configuration?
Why can't
the second upper electron be expelled?
There is not enough energy.
It's not?
No, that's all.
Okay, because it's strongly bound because it's an ion.
First of all, the energy is shifted, it's an ion, And second, the neighbor can be any, the same kind or one which is easier to ionize, it depends, But it's correct, it's an ion. So to take out the first electron of helium is 24, the second is 50-something. All right. So I'll give you two examples only. I would like to start with water because there are recent measurements on ICD in water. There are a number of papers now, experimental. I will discuss only two. The point is that ICD in water tells you, and water is omnipresent in biological systems, for example, that ICD will be important in biological systems. And of course, water is the first example which was measured, which is beyond rare gases, which that's why it's important. Now, I will discuss briefly two papers by the Dirner group, which I mentioned already. It's a water dimer, so they have electron-ion coincidence experiments on the dimer. And it's very important that there are also in parallel measurements on larger water clusters where they have developed a new method to identify ICD, because you have to be sure that it's not something else. And it's important because even if it is, so to say, operative in a dimer, it doesn't mean that in a big system exactly the same stuff happens. It could be that there are some other competing processes, and they are not. So that's important too. And let me see. And here, I hope you can see, it looks a bit faded to me from here. So that's the experiments on the dimer. So these are coincidence experiments. And you can also see by integrating over the other kind of particle, for example, over the electrons, you see the kinetic energy release by the two waters. And here I should add that the two waters, so after ICD, you have water plus. You start with water plus. An electron moves away from the other water by ICD. You have two water ions. And the process seems to be so fast that the two water ions just fly apart without any time for proton exchange. So they measure only two intact H2O pluses, which is important too. And you see the electron distribution. This is due. This you should subtract. It's due to the photoelectrons. They show the synchrotron wavelengths, which gives you photoelectrons here. So it goes down like that to about 10 eV or so. And so you see here that the electrons peak. They're very slow. They peak at around zero, and it goes about to 10. This is a very old calculation by us. It's similar, but it has some more structure. And now in the large clusters, this is a photoelectron experiment. Those who are used to photoelectron experiments, they see in this part a normal photoelectron of water. Even water molecule looks similar. But you see here at low energy, a big peak comes after you ionize the H2O, so the oxygen 2s electron, that's the inner valence electron. If you remove that, this gives rise to ICD, slow ICD electrons. And also here, the distribution of ICD electrons is between 0 and 10. Maybe it peaks a little different, but it's between 0 and 10. And as I said, this is very relevant because it was found that it's the slow electrons who by dissociative attachment break the DNA strands, single strand breaks and even double strand breaks, which are irreparable, are done by slow electrons. And here you have the slow electron produced at the site, as I said, where you excite. Now, because of that, we had a look at building blocks of peptides or biochemically relevant systems. So there are hydrogen bonds, and I will not go too much into detail. So we studied those seven dimers, so all with water. So you can have, for example, let's take here H2S and water. You can have a place where the water is electron acceptor or an electron donor. So they are a bit different, but all of them show ICD when you ionize either the oxygen, sulfur, and nitrogen, and so on. So all of them, ICD seems to be an open channel. And ICD in hydrogen bonded systems, here is an example. We calculated all of those. It's formaldehyde and water, for example. And you see here the computed ionization, so like a photoelectron spectrum, but a computed one at fixed geometry and of this complex. And you can see that the energies of the oxygen of water and oxygen of formaldehyde ionization energy are here. And the threshold to double ionization, these are the double ionization potentials, the threshold is here. So all these levels, after ionizing an inner valence electron, removing an inner valence electron, all this level are above threshold, and it will ICD will take place, and you will kick out an electron from the neighbor. And again, the distribution is about up to about 80 V, so low electrons are produced here. Okay, now before I go, since our study on ICD in a free electron laser was done on a neon dimer, because it's enormous calculations, we cannot do it yet at all on water or something like that. I would like to talk about van der Waals cluster very, very briefly, and particularly on the neon dimer without the free electron laser, that you see what's going on. And you see that Robin was very involved in those works. And here we see the ionization spectrum of a neon atom. So you remove the 2p electron, it's about 22 eV. You remove the neon 2s electron, it's about 48 eV, which you need. And if you ask for, this was your question, if you ask why there is no Auger, the threshold for single, threshold for double ionization, so it means neon 2 plus is 60. So about 12 eV are missing, and it cannot decay by electron emission, it can only decay by photon emission, and this takes nanoseconds. Now, if I take a neon dimer, the energies will not really change because the two neons just stand around at some distance over 3 angstrom, and there is hardly any interaction. It's a very weak van der Waals interaction. And now you have, again, the same thresholds essentially. So these are the one side where you remove the second electron from the same neon, and this is, again, much too high in energy, but you have the two-side threshold, neon plus, which is about 15 eV lower, and now the channel is open. Now this level can decay by emitting an electron from the neighbor. Then you have neon plus, and you have the Coulomb explosion, and it was all very nicely measured. Now what happens if I have more neighbors, and I mentioned it, that it becomes much faster when you have more neighbors. In neon dimer, the ICD lifetime, so if you have a neighbor in the equilibrium distance, the lifetime is about 80 femtoseconds. In water, by the way, it's about 5 or 6 femtoseconds in that range, so it's much faster in the hydrogen bonded systems. And but have a look at that. If let's say I remove from the central neon the 2s electron, now I can have ICD to the left. It means energy will be transferred to the left and kick out the electron. It's the same, since they don't really interact, the neutral species don't really interact, it means that you have, again, about 80 femtoseconds, like in the dimer. But the energy can be transferred as well to the right and kick out an electron from there. And it's the same probability. So you have twice the probability, you will have about half the lifetime. So it will be already 40. And if you arrive, when you arrive here, when this is a natural next sort of neighbors of a neon, in a big neon cluster or in a neon solid, you have 12 neighbors, the lifetime will be just a few femtoseconds. And this was measured. So you can in principle see that more neighbors, even neon becomes a bomb. Yeah? It's comparable to the OJ of an inner core in those systems. Here you see the plot. This is the decay width or rate as a function of neon atoms in this cluster. So it's zero, of course, if you have neon alone. It will only be by photo emission, and then it really grows linearly, and then it even grows faster due to some collective effects, which I will not talk about. And if you look at the lifetime, it's about 80 femtoseconds, and it goes down to just a few femtoseconds if you take the full next shell into account. Now I go to actually the title of my talk. So we thought about what to do if you have a free electron laser at your disposal, sufficient intensity, and also, of course, that you also have the frequencies we need. So here is a cartoon and the scheme. So if you ionize, let's say we have a free electron laser pulse coming, it has sufficiently many photons, so you can, if you ionize the outer electron, one of the outer electrons, and if the energy of this pulse fits into an excitation of, let's say, an inner valence up, so you now create, by the second photon, a hole in the shell, inner valence shell, where you can have ICD. Now there will be ICD, it will fall back, the energy will be transferred to the neighbor, kick out an electron there, then you have neon plus, like in the usual ICD, and you will have a Coulomb explosion, and you can measure, for example, if this is a neon dimer, you could measure the neon plus yield, and if possible, also the electron distribution of all the electrons, because one should not forget that the same pulse could also one photon ionize one neon and one, let's say, the other neon. Then you'll also have neon plus by a different mechanism, and I'll show you the competition and interference. If the pulse is coherent, then you really have interference of these two processes, and the interference is enormous, and this surprised me, actually, and I would like to discuss now. So to go into some details, not too many, these are the computed potential energy curves of all the involved states. So this is neon dimer ground state. This is a very different scale. Okay, so it's very, very shallow. The minimum is about 3.1 eV. Angstrom, sorry, I'm too much into the energy business, seems. And here you in the first photon, you ionize. Here we chose a photon of about that energy. I'll give you more details later. So the first photon ionizes, like I said, one neon. You see neon plus 2p minus 1. And there are four states there. So all four states can be ionized. Then the second photon takes you to the neon plus 2s minus 1, where the hole is now in the 2s shell. And you have two states there. And this can now decay to the to the final states, neon plus, which are essentially 1 over r in atomic units, very steep curves compared to those. So you can decay and emit an electron of this small energy. You see, it's small energies. The ICD electrons have relatively small energy. Now, let me first show you what happens at relatively low intensity. So this is intensity in units of 10 to the 10 watts per centimeter square. So like we said, we need at that photon energy of about 27, we need two photons at least. So you see indeed essentially a quadratic, at lower low intensity, a quadratic behavior. So these are the calculated points. So up to hereabouts, it's really nicely quadratic. And if we want to compare it with something would be more standard, so we take, let's say, twice the frequency, the same intensity, twice the frequency, and the same pulse of 60 femtoseconds in this case, and then you find much less ICD, or here it's essentially still only ICD at these intensities, you find much less. So it means a two-photon process triggers much more ICD than a single-photon process, which is nice. And already at relatively low intensity. You see here, this intensity is quite low, and it's still quite much quite more pronounced. Now, here you see the electron spectra at different pulse duration and intensities. So we have two pulses. I think here this was 60 femtosecond, this 30, and different intensities, peak intensities. But let's concentrate on one. You cannot follow so fast all the details, of course. But here we see the fraction, after the pulse is over, the fraction of neutrals, which dimers which have survived, and the fraction of single ions which, so to say, survived. All others are neon plus pairs. So it means it either ICD or direct ionization of the two neons. Okay, this. So the total yield of these neon plus or electrons in coincidence, doesn't matter, are the red curves. And ICD alone are the black curves. Ah, you see it here. Ah, it's even here. I'm standing too near, so I didn't really find it. So ICD are the broken black curves, and the total yield of neon plus ions or electrons, emitted electrons in coincidence, are the red curves. And you see in the beginning, as it means at low intensity of about 10 to the power of 11, it's essentially only ICD. Then you start to see also direct ionization of the two neons, and of course, the higher you go, you will see more and more ionization of the two neons. But there is enormous interference here, so it's misleading to think that the difference is due to direct ionization. I thought so in the beginning, and then we looked at it, and we were very surprised. So here you see a breakup of the contributions in one case. This is 30 femtosecond and this intensity. And you see about 50% of the neutrals have survived the pulse, so it's not a very strong pulse. So ICD alone is a broken curve. Then the total is red, as before. And if you calculate only the direct, you don't allow for ICD, and you calculate only the direct ionization of the two neons by two photons, so to say, or by the pulse, you get this blue broken curve. So it's not at all the difference here, of course. So most of it is really a question of interference to get the total. And now I address a last point concerning these results, is how to measure the ICD alone. I mean, this is a calculation. We can, of course, calculate ICD alone, but we would like to know how to measure it. Now, ICD in the neon dimer would take about 80 femtoseconds. So if the pulse is shorter, like 30 femtoseconds, then, of course, when most of the ICD happens after the pulse is over. Okay, so the direct ionization of the two neons is only during the pulse. So if we measure, so to say, the total yield after long time, or the total yield up to 30 femtoseconds, let's say, then the pulse is over, and we subtract. So this is measured the total yield up to 30 femtoseconds. And if you subtract, you get the green curve, and the calculated ICD alone is the broken curve here. So, of course, you could take even a shorter pulse and get better agreement, but this is just to show that you can play also and learn about the times of the processes by such measurements. And now, I didn't tell you anything about theory, and I will not tell you much because my time is probably, how much time do I have? I still have time.
Still something like close to 10 minutes.
Oh, great. I will be finished even before, I guess. So now, the calculations are rather involved because what one does not realize is that in a laser field, if you have a resonance, for example, if you excite, for example, of the 2s electron up to the 2p, you have two levels, this is quite general. These two levels, if you have a resonant frequency, the potential curves will cross. And at this crossing, if you take the rotational angle, rotational will mean the angle between the polarization of the light and the axis of the molecule, is now a dynamical variable and not fixed. So if you fix it, you lose most of the information. If you take it as a dynamical variable, you will find that there is a conical intersection between the two surfaces. And those who have ever heard about conical intersections, they know that at conical intersection, the non-adiabatic effects are maximal. So you have a very strong mixing of the two electronic states and of the vibrational coordinate r and of the rotation. So even if you start with j equals 0, afterwards you will have j up to 30, 40, whatever you like after the process because of this very strong non-adiabatic mixture. Now, in our case, it's even a little more complicated because we have decay. This would be the case for stationary states. But if you have decay, the surfaces will become complex because of the decay time or decay rate which you have. And then, instead of a conical intersection, one has something which I, long time ago, actually, I called doubly intersecting complex energy surfaces because there are two intersections where both the real part and the imaginary part of the surfaces, these are real cases, intersect at two points in the coordinate space. And the coordinate here are r and theta, so the rotational angle and the vibrational. And also at these two points, the non-adiabatic coupling are singular, like in the conical intersection. And the effect on this coupling is enormous. And we see it also in this neon dimer when we compute the spectra or the process. We see in the wave function that the wave function becomes very, very mixed and totally non-adiabatic. So this plays a role, and you don't see too much. I will not go into detail. Here is you have to build some wave packet which has everything, the rotation, the vibration, the coupling to the, of course, to the field, and so on, and ionization probabilities by the photons because of the high intensity. And finally, let me summarize what we saw in the last part of the talk, that ICD is enhanced by two-photon absorption is more efficient than one-photon absorption of double frequency, which of sufficient frequency to ionize directly the decaying state. Then, of course, we have a sequential two-photon absorption by the two neon atoms, and they strongly interfere. We have strong interference. And you can also measure the different parts of the spectrum, for example, different contribution, for example, ICD, by doing time-dependent measurements. So you measure up to some time. And by subtraction, I showed you can determine the ICD. And of course, I have to thank many, many people over the years. The list is not complete because it's full. sorry. But we have quite many people who worked. The field did not emerge by itself. Many people contributed, and I'm very thankful for that. And we have also collaborations with Nimrod, Francesco, and some experimental groups. And thank you for your attention.